Hey, hello, and welcome to the show. It's me, John Park. It's time for John Park's workshop right here in my workshop. You and me, let's get together and make some stuff and look at some things and have some fun, huh? Let's see, what am I up to today? I've got a new project. I also want to do a little bit of a walkthrough of a learn guide from the previous project. Do a little update on the Frogger situation over there, and some ideas for the future of that setup, and some things I've learned. What else? I've got a coupon code for you today. If you want to go to the Adafruit store and get some good stuff and get 10% off on it, I will help you with that. I've got a CircuitPython parsec. I've got a 1-minute wrap-up of this week's product pick. And I've got a really cool, with this new project for today, I've got a really cool artifact of the 1970s, late 70s to show you. You might have seen it on the show and tell last night. You might also see it sitting right over there, but we'll get to that. And when I say we, I mean me and you and all of us together in our chats. And if you're wondering where the chats are, you can head on over to either YouTube or to our Discord server. That's the main place where we engage with the chatness. You can get there by going to adafruit.it/discord and then look for the live broadcast chat channel. This is it right here. You can see, in fact, I've got the whole list of, or part of the list at least, of the many different channels that we have. You can see there we have a general chat, we have help with channels for all kinds of topics, including CircuitPython, 3D printing, Arduino, make code, robotics. There's also these topics such as the CircuitPython dev, where the devs hang out, and you could be one of them if you're interested in working on CircuitPython itself, and on and on. So that's our chat. Hello, everyone. Hey, DJ Devin, Katney, Andy Calloway, Mike P, Paul Cutler, Toddbot, welcome, and nice to see you all. Hey, Dave Odessa, nice to see you over in the YouTube chat. Thanks for joining us today. Let's see, what else do we have? I think my monitor is freaking me out. I think it's tilted a little. Is that normal? Looks a little weird. So to start it off, I mentioned that we have a coupon code for today, and that is it right there, Brain Battle, Brain-Battle. That will get you 10% off in the Adafruit store today. Just head on over to Adafruit and you can poke around in the different product categories there. You can look for new stuff by simply scrolling down into this new product section and click on view all new products. There's some banners that pop out, some different stuff, some featured products, and you can throw some stuff in your cart. As long as it's stuff and not software or gift certificates or subscriptions to things. But if you get physical stuff, 10% off. And if you want to get free stuff, check this out. Adafruit.com/free. There are some of the goodies that you can get if you buy enough stuff. So if you order $149 or more, you get a free KB2040. If you order $200 or more, you get free UPS ground shipping in the continental United States. For a order of $2.99 or more, you get a Circuit Playground Express thrown in there. And these stack, so you can get them all. If you do the $2.99, you're going to get the $149 and the $200 and the $2.99 freebies. So some cool stuff there. If you're interested in getting a big order put together, do it. It's how we operate, right? That's why I'm here, is because we sell stuff as well as, of course, putting together content and libraries and code and examples and help you use this stuff. But the stuff is actually what brings in the money and pays the bills. So we appreciate if you get some stuff. And you probably will, too, if you want to make things. It's good stuff to have around. What else? Speaking of stuff, right? That's the show I do on Tuesdays, Product Pick of the Week. I grab a new product off our shelf, and I put it through its paces and show you how it works. And I got a 50% off discount during the live stream only this week on this one. So those NeoKey BFFs were going like hotcakes for half price. Here is a little one-minute recap. It is the NeoKey BFF. This is a little best friend forever add-on for a cutie pie. So take your cutie pie, take your BFF, marry them together. This one allows you to take a Cherry MX compatible mechanical key switch, plug that into the socketed receptacles for the two pins there, and now you have a mechanical key switch. I've put it in a very minimalist configuration with header pins, so it's just plugged right onto the bottom. It has a reverse mount NeoPixel, and then it has the sockets for a mechanical key switch to plug in. You can see it in action. When I press it, it is glowing red, and it's also sending a USB HID command to my broadcast software to bring on a delicious plate of gnocchi. It is the NeoKey BFF. That's right, that's what it is. And speaking of which, Toddbot posed the question, why don't we offer snacks for sale? You want to order some snacks along with your Adafruit stuff? Don't order gnocchi. In fact, just hand make it. Don't. Gnocchi is only good when it's fresh. So we will not ship you any gnocchi. Sorry. Let's see. What else is happening here? I'm just going to disappear my camera by accident. There, I'm back. Let's jump into. I like to do these every week. These are the CircuitPython Parsec, if you're not familiar with it. I like to give you a little tip or trick on coding in CircuitPython or using one of our neat little boards or add-ons or sensors or breakouts in CircuitPython. So I've got a neat little one here for you today, so check it out. Okay. For the CircuitPython Parsec today, I wanted to show you how you can read analog inputs on ATtiny 816 Stemma breakout board. So here you can see I have this neat little breakout board, and it is running over I2C using this Stemma QT cable to my Feather. But that could be any board with I2C, really. It has a bunch of inputs and outputs built into it, and we can talk to those inputs, which are being dealt with right on board with that ATtiny, over I2C to find out what's going on. So you've got 9 analog inputs on this. So you could add a ton of analog input to a project and then communicate over I2C to find out what those knobs or other analog inputs are doing. In this case, you can see I have 3 little knobs wired up to it. And if you look in my code window there, it's reporting those values as I change them. Knob 0, knob 1, and knob 2, but that could be up to 9, in fact, on this little board. And if you want to know how to do this, first of all, I'm importing Seesaw, and I'm importing the analog input class inside of Seesaw. Then I set up I2C on the Stemma QT I2C bus of my Feather, and then I create that Seesaw object. Then I'm setting up these variables called knob 0, 1, and 2, and those are analog inputs on the Seesaw pins 0, 1, and 2. And then I'm creating a variable called K0, K1, K2, and those stand for whatever the value is of each of those analog inputs. I'm also setting up a variable set to compare, and that's the last K, 0, 1, 2. And then during the main loop, what I do is I pull those 3 analog inputs and say, let's find out what those values are. Then we run this little test. We say, if K0 is not the same as the last time, or 1 or 2, then we'll go ahead and print whatever those values are and then update that variable so that it holds those values for the next time we change them. And you can see it's a really simple, easy way for me to add these three analog inputs, and then I can go and use these knobs for other interesting things like lighting and sound and USB interfaces and so on. And so that is how you can use the ATtiny 816 as a stemma board to read analog inputs inside of CircuitPython. And that is your CircuitPython Parsec. Hey, all right, we're back. I wanted to set up a big, huge board of these, but I figured this would be a little simpler to keep it contained. But I might do a project in the future where I've got a ton of knobs running over one of these little boards. A super convenient way to add that kind of functionality, as you can see there. All right, so next up, let's dive into the world. This is something the Ruiz brothers do. I was watching their show yesterday and I really like it, which is a bit of a walkthrough of a learn guide. So this is, let me set this up here. This is my keyboard that I made, the little hex pad. And I can give this some USB-C power. I'm just trying to pull the blue tack off of my USB cable. I was using that the other day to keep stuff from bouncing around too much on the desk. That stuff is sticky. So this is my little Cutie Pie RP2040 based hex keypad. And this right now, you'll just see a light show. I'm not using it to send any, or rather it's sending MIDI, but I don't have any synthesizer running right now, so you won't hear anything. But the way this was set up, I wanted to show you the learn guide that I put together for this. So if we jump over here, you can see this got published yesterday, and the demo video in here is sort of a little placeholder. This is a really cool little demo video that Noah put together, but he's doing a full-blown video in his really beautiful style of project build videos and project demonstration videos that'll be coming soon. I think it'll be out next week. But first of all, I just wanted to show this one. It should be able to play. Hopefully you can hear this. Okay, so that's a little demo. Sorry about the flickering camera. I don't know if you're seeing that, but my camera setup didn't love the video playing there inside of a browser window. So that's what it does. In case you hadn't seen some of the previous episodes, it is a MIDI keypad that can play within a predefined scale or set of scales, either single notes or chords, and you can play the notes together or play chords upon chords together. And this is something I built from scratch. So it is running on the Cutie Pie RP2040 just to keep it minimal, and it's a great board for doing HID projects, be it MIDI or USB. And then I'm using these Kale low-profile switches. Do I have any right here? No, just inside of the thing itself. Yeah, I don't think I have any on my desk. But you can see here, these are key switches that look a lot like the sort of typical MX switch, but they're a lot shorter, and they happen to have a different footprint on the bottom, so we couldn't reuse existing parts footprints for this. You can see I'm also using our little reverse mount NeoPixels. I heard someone call them Gullwing NeoPixels the other day. In fact, the person who called them that was this person, Sol, who is the designer of these hexagonal keycaps, said, oh, I didn't know those little Gullwing NeoPixels would fit under the chalk. The chalk has a little window cut out for LEDs to shine up through, and in fact these do fit pretty nicely in there. And those key switches that you can see here, those are really beautiful diffuse key switches, or keycaps, sorry, that I inspired the whole project really. And those are not easily available at the moment. I think they're going to be going into production. And so Noah put together a 3D printable version of it, and we'll see that in a second. There's actually some instructions there for ordering them to be printed in clear resin if you want to have them made that way, which is nice because it really tight tolerances and a great look. So the first thing I had to do was build these parts inside of Fritzing, because I wanted to use Fritzing both for visualizing the design on a breadboard and then putting together the schematic and ultimately putting together the PCB. So that process, I've got some links in here that show you other guides I've done about breadboarding and part building inside of Fritzing, as well as some links to places to learn more about that. The process itself is largely something that you create in a vector illustration program such as Illustrator or Inkscape. And by building things on a certain 0.1 inch grid with certain colors and layer names, you can then import that SVG into Fritzing and it kind of knows what to do with it. And then there's additional setup you'll do. So there's the PCB, or rather the breadboard version of it. Here is my schematic. Let's go to the full size one you can see here. And one thing I'm doing in here, if you're not familiar with schematic setup inside of your PCB software or your schematic software, is the use of net labels. So rather than have a million wires running everywhere, we can use these sort of little remote tags. So if I tag something with a net label that says A1, then I can go put that A1 somewhere else, and it's down here at the bottom right, you can see. That essentially prevents us from having to really run the traces everywhere. It wouldn't be terrible in this project because it's not a huge number of parts, but it's helpful to get used to this notion. Same with ground, you can see I'm not running every part to the one ground on the cutie pie that I have there. Instead, I'm using these little symbols to do a sort of abstracted version of that, sort of an alias for the ground rather than running all the wires to the actual ground on the board. And you can see these parts are all made up of essentially two things. I have the key switch, which is a two-pin switch, and then I have the NeoPixel, which is four pins dealing with the voltage, ground, data in, and data out. And so once I've gotten that all set up here, I can then start looking at the PCB building. Now, you'll see the next thing I mentioned here is custom PCB shape. So this is what your typical blank PCB looks like in most CAD software, including in Fritzing. We wanted something a little more stylish. I wanted something that would sort of fit the aesthetic of the hexagonal sort of beehive honeycomb type of shape here. And so I have a little link there that shows you the instructions for doing this, which is, again, creating an SVG in an Illustrator Inkscape, and giving your objects and layers certain names. And then you can import that inside of Fritzing, and it'll take over that rectangular shape with your properly designed PCB here. So there's a little link there that'll show you how to do that. Then I have a link going out to another guide I had done on building your parts and building your PCB. So this doesn't vary from that much. It's just the specifics of this board. And you can see here, I've got my seven switches. I've got my seven NeoPixels. I've got my cutie pie, which most of that stuff is mounted on the top, but then I've got the cutie pie mounted on the bottom. And I just had to be careful to fit that in among things so nothing overlapped, but it was just possible, just barely possible. And then I went and routed it. So that's covered in that other guide, but you can see here essentially in this top view, the green one there, you can see little traces running out to their different pads. And then the bottom view there, same sort of thing. Some of that is little vias that jumper a trace underneath some stuff so things don't cross. And then the majority of that is a big ground pad. So a lot of the components that go to ground don't need to travel across a trace somewhere. They can just locally have that big copper pad, copper fill there. And then I've got the Fritzing file right there. So you can see there, hexboard V2.3.fzz. That is the Fritzing scene or session file. Now, the nice thing about that is it is actually a zip file. You can actually rename, I think you can rename that zip, open it up and look at it. And what you'll find in there are a collection of files that include the parts. So it embeds the parts in there, as well as the schematic view, breadboard view, and the PCB view. So all that stuff lives in there. You can just download that and open it into Fritzing. It should not yell at you about missing parts because they're all baked into it. And you can also open that up and explore those files if you want to. Most of those are XML files or SVG files, so you can kind of noodle around a bit, although sometimes it's difficult to hand edit things and have Fritzing still be happy with it, I've found. And I'm not sure if that's checksums or something else. Then I've got a link to a page that goes into the details of ordering a PCB. You can get them through Oshpark, JLC PCB, PCBWay, the DigiKey, who else? There's a number of services out there. And I don't know, we may have a general guide on getting your PCBs made. And those are all places where you can do that. And it usually takes a week or two and you'll get your PCB in the board, usually a minimum order of 3 to 5 of them, depending. And then we get those in and put them together. So here you can see the first thing I did was solder in the LEDs. Now, I happened to, for reasons of Fritzing not loving my part being a surface mount part on the bottom of the board with through-hole parts on the top of the board, it was making some selections difficult. So even though these kind of are meant to be surface mount pads on the bottom of the board, they work fine in this case mounting from the top. So the only downside there is that it would be impossible to get in there and touch up a cold solder joint on the NeoPixel if it happened, because the key switch is going to get soldered right on top of it. So ideally these would be in from the bottom, but I haven't had any problems with these in from the top. You can see then the next, let me go back. Next thing I did was solder in headers, and this is really important. So this is for these header pins that the Cutie Pie is connected to. And you can see I laid that down on the table and then pushed down the little plastic spacers so that it was flush. And that's because I want the tops of the pins flush with the top of the board so that that one key switch will fit on top of it without bumping into anything. So we solder that flush. Don't solder the Cutie Pie in yet. Just get the header pins in and it'll look like this. So you can see there. It's a little bit of a mess. There's some flux and stuff there. I actually had to desolder some stuff and ended up with it looking not so pretty, but it all works fine. So you can see there, pretty tight tolerance in the NeoPixel next to the, there we go. My thing didn't refresh. Let me zoom in on this properly. You can see the NeoPixel and that one pin. They're kind of close, yeah. And these are just an artifact. These little three pads are an artifact of the Cutie Pie part. When you put that in, they're not connected to anything. They're not going to bother anything. They're just there. But you can see these are all soldered in flush so that we can then flip it over and solder in the key switches. So here you can see key switches. That one's right on top of where those pads are, or those pins rather, for the Cutie Pie, and you can see one of the pads right there, or pins right there. So you'll go through and add all of those. You can't get the orientation wrong, which is great, because the three sort of registration pegs go into the holes, and then the legs fit down below, and that is oriented so that the NeoPixel will shine through the little cutout in the bottom of the key switch. These key switches happen to have a black opaque bottom, so we want to make sure we're shining through those little rectangles that are cut out there. So that's with two of them in there. There you go. There's all four, or rather all seven. Then we can solder in the Cutie Pie. So come back to this, solder that Cutie Pie in on the other side, and nothing will be blocked. And then you can also snip those little excess pins, if you like, off the top and touch up the solder, if you like. Then we get to, this is cool, this is the case build. So you can see I printed mine in a single yellow filament. This is a PLA. I'm forgetting the name of the one that I like. It's a matte finish. Is it Polyfill? It might be the brand Polyfill. It's kind of a matte finish that I like, the way it feels and looks. However, I sent this file, the model file, to Noé Ruiz, and he decided to adjust it so that it could be printed with multiple colors using some filament change post-processing in the G-code setup. So on his page here, first of all, we've got the CAD files you can download, the STEP file and the STL file. I think the STEP is still in there. And then there's some instructions here. These are particular to Cura, but these should exist in any slicer package you use, is how to tell it to stop after a certain layer and initiate a filament change. Excuse me, so you can manually, you don't need a fancy machine that does it for you. You can just say, okay, pop out the old one, put in the new one, let it do another quarter of the height, essentially. It changes again, so you get to do multiple filament changes, and you get this really cool sort of B stripes kind of shape. I just noticed in the chat, Todd said Polymaker Matte PLA. I think that's the one I'm using, not Polyfill. Yeah, I think Polymaker Matte PLA is the one I use that I really like. Yeah, I use their black a lot, and I've gotten a nice blue and a yellow now. So here's more info about how to set up where you're doing those filament changes. There's also some support material that Noé put in to, you might be able to see, I've got some little fuzzies here because I printed without support in my USB jack, but Noé shows you how to use a little sort of localized specific support so that it doesn't do that, which is great. And then you can see here from the bottom side, there are six holes for an M3 screw. You'll use six 5 millimeter long M3 screws. And then he's got the info about the printable keycaps. So I would say if you can, buy the ones that Sol Bekic created. They're amazing, they're awesome. They're also not available, I think, through most retailers at the moment. So if you're impatient, then print them for now, but maybe go back and buy some of his to thank the designer for their excellent design. And there are CAD files for 3D printing the similar ones. I think these are flat on top. They're not dished like these are. These have a nice little scoop in them. You might be able to see if I unplug a little better. And these are made from, I think, HDPE, which is similar to like a milk jug material. And so they have a really nice feel, very durable, and they have great diffusion properties. If you want other colors, though, you're definitely going to want to 3D print them. Noé shows you how to send these to PCBWay to get them 3D printed. And if you want these incredible looking crystal clear keycaps, then you can use this UTR 8100 transparent material. And then there are some specific settings on there. I believe you can also do a translucent version of that that is sort of frosted. And I think Anne Barella created one of the floppy disk cases for the Pi Portal in that material. Looks great, really nice frosty translucent finish. So I'm looking forward to trying some of those. I haven't tried any of those resin prints yet. Then I've got a mirrored page there for your CircuitPython setup for the Qt Pi. Just in case you wondered, we do not rewrite this page every time. We have a setup in our Learn Guide authoring where we can mirror in one page all over the place. That's a standard that gets used a lot. So this is the CircuitPython setup page for specific to this board. So we have one specific to each board. So that gets mirrored into the guide there, but it covers all of the specifics you need about putting CircuitPython onto the particular board that we're using in that guide. Then this one is specific, and this is coding and using your hex pad. So tells you what to download as far as libraries go. You can also just download the project bundle. So this link here is automatically generated when we PR the code up into the Learn repo. It collects up any of the assets and libraries and puts those into one bundle, fonts, things like that. We put them all into that bundle. But this is the code. So I've gone through this before. I won't go through it again right here and now, but it's essentially a USB MIDI project with some specific lists of notes that you can use. And I've also got some setup on here, which is kind of cool. I'll show that actually in the overhead real quick. Let's go to this view for a second. So I'll play. Let me turn on a synthesizer. You should be able to hear. Okay, so you can hear right now. Let me make that a little less grating. Let's go to keys. Ooh, that's not what I wanted at all. A pad. How about soothing? Sure. So you should be able to hear that's playing a chord. There's multiple notes playing there. With different roots, and the particular mode, which is the sort of set of notes that are playing together, in this case is, I think I have it starting out in a major with a root of C. So what I set up was, you can change in code what it defaults to, but you can also now go and press the boot button on the Cutie Pie, which serves as a user button. After you get past the boot part of the process, it just can be used as a user button. So if I press that, this now goes into a config mode. And if I open up this view real quick, and you can see in my, this is not the code that's running here, but you can see, oh, that did it, hold on. I think I broke it. One second. Command palette terminus. I'm going to open the code file off of this. Why not? And then disco tool to the cutie pie. Okay, so I just pressed the boot button. It says launching config and then choose mode. So essentially right now you can choose one of the seven modes that are presets here. So we can choose major, minor, Dorian, Phrygian, Lydian, Mixolydian, and Locrian. So I'll do minor. So it just said, okay, mode one. Now choose which octave. So let's have this start pretty high. Choose the root note. And now do you want chords or single notes? So I'll say let's do single notes. Okay, so now it's set up. Oh, MIDI panic. Sorry. That's the other bonus feature. I didn't mean that to happen, but when I press the boot button, it sends MIDI panic, which turns off all notes. But we're now back to picking the modes. So let's do minor. What did I do? Octave, root, and single notes. Hopefully this doesn't break. Is it the, hold on. All right, bad demo, I need to check that. Maybe I got an error in my code. I don't know why it's, I've tested it plenty, so I don't think that's it. For some reason it's not sending the, yeah, now it is. I don't know what was going on there. But I'll double check that later, but that's the, kind of cool mode select feature. And this is something I've shown in CircuitPython Parsec before. It's a really nice user interface method when you want someone to answer some questions. You can run things in this while not mode picked. So I set a bunch of variables for whether something has been, some condition has been satisfied or not. And then I just run through, I say pick the mode, and now we can move on at the end of that function to pick the octave and so on. So it just waits there for you to pick something. Okay, let's try it one more time. All right, so we'll go about single notes. Yeah, it's definitely not sending a note off. Let's just try that again, but with chords. Maybe I screwed up the single note thing. So mode, octave, root, and chords. Yep. Weird. I tested that plenty. I don't know what I broke. Let's see. Let's look at our play note. Oh, is it when I'm releasing it? Let's see. If the key switch is pressed, send note off, note picked. Yeah, it does the same thing whether we're in chord or single mode, so I don't know why. All right. Well, I'll get to go look at that. That's the benefit of actually demoing it live, is now I've found a bug. So back to learn guide here. There's the code. There's a little quick demo there. Like I said, now I was working on a full-blown one. And then I got some suggestions for some different synth software that you can run. All these are, I think these are all free ones, even open source in many cases. You can use this with an iOS device. I recommend checking out AudioKit Synth 1. Super fully featured synth on iOS devices, both iPad and iPhone. And it'll run on even a moderately oldish one, so if you have a spare older iPad or something kicking around, you can turn it into your synth machine. There's some browser-based software we can use, as well as some full applications for Linux, Windows, and Mac there. And here is my, since I mentioned the configuration mode, here are your, this is kind of your map for when you're doing that, so that's what the different modes you can pick are. These are the different octaves, these are the different root keys you can choose. I don't have a provision for doing any sharps and flats, so if you want that, you can add that just in the code by adjusting, shifting your numbers. And then there's the chord versus single mode. And then I got a little bit of a code explainer there, and we talk about LED colors, and then the main loop of the program. So that is it. That is the learn guide for my little hex pad there. I hope you like it, and let me know if you have any feedback if you put one together, or if you notice what I'm doing in my code that's making the notes not release in single mode. I'd love to hear it. Could be operator error or two on my synth software there. All right, let's see. Next up, I wanted to talk about the quick update on Frogger. So I got Frogger over here. Let's jump over to the main cam, and I'll zoom up in on that real quick. And see if I can focus a little tighter. That's it. Okay. I'll turn off at least a couple of these lights just to get rid of some of that glare too. So I've moved it. I've moved this setup. I've now got the arcade board with my little homemade wiring harness. I've got the power supply. This is the coin collector box, which I don't have hooked up to it at the moment. I'm just using a button. It's just way more convenient. And then I got a little speaker over here. Here's my monitor. And then I can't remember if I did this last week, but I put the two buttons that I need for, one's the coin, I'm just simulating coin drops with that, and this is the player one start and the joystick. Those are all I need for Frogger. I have two other buttons plugged into the harness there. And I'll go ahead and power this on. The main thing I'll mention is that I figured out the dip switches. They are, now that everything else is working, it's much easier to test the dip switches. They are exactly as the Frogger manual states they are. So I had it set to the first two dip switches, I think, were off and off, which was giving me 256 lives or something crazy like that. So I think they're both on now, which is three lives. Yeah. When I hit a credit now, it'll say one player only, yada, yada, yada. Hit start. You can see now I've got one frog ready to go and two sitting in the wings there. Game over. So before I was never experiencing game over because it was set to unlimited lives or 256 lives. The next dip switch is the upright versus cocktail cabinet mode. I won't demonstrate this now until maybe later. I'll tell you about some plans we have for this. In cocktail cabinet mode, the idea is that it would be horizontal on a little table, and you would sit across from each other, and there'd be a joystick on either side. So if you're playing a two-player game, when it switches after each life to the other player, it flips the screen upside down so that it's in the proper orientation for the other player. So that, I now have gotten that to work, and I just have one sort of jumper wire connected that I was using to test adding a second player. And then the last two dip switches are how many lives or how many credits you get per coin drop. So last week I was thinking that my coin counter was sending out only one pulse when this wanted two pulses. Not really, it just wanted 50 cents. The dip switches were set to say you need two coins per credit. So I've flipped those both of those dip switches, I think, to up. Yeah, the last two dip switches are both up, and that's basically one play per quarter, one play per coin drop now. And that's why now when I press, it's immediately saying, ding, I got a coin, and credit equals one. Before it was going, ding, still on credit zero, and then I hit a second time. So that's the update on that. The fun place this may be going is we're looking at trying to do possibly some reading of the direct RGB and sync signals that are on the arcade board when they're in, let's see, do I have a board available? No. When they're in their digital mode, there's a red, green, blue, and sync digital signal, which then go through like a ladder filter to become analog. But it's possible, Phil B's been looking into this, it may be possible to grab those signals in their pure digital RGB sync form, which can then be potentially utilized in a digital video setup, which is definitely interesting. I love CRTs, but it would be really interesting to see the purest possible signal coming off of the video circuitry of that board. So that's what's up with Frogger there. The other thing I'm looking at is, as I've mentioned, I think that board that I have is actually originally a Konami Scramble board, and the ROMs have been swapped for Frogger. It's actually a bootleg of Frogger called Frog. And there are some modifications, some bodge wires on it that I believe were used to allow the Scramble board to play those ROMs. I could be wrong on that. I don't know a lot about it. I've read the Scramble board doesn't really have lockout security like later boards where they didn't let you swap ROMs, but it's a really popular board for ROM swaps. There are a lot of different games that can run on that board. So I'm looking into what it would take to get some of the blank ROMs and a ROM EEPROM writer and do some other games. I'd love to convert one back to Scramble, actually, but we'll see if anyone has expertise in that, if anyone's done ROM swap kind of stuff on older arcade boards. This is actually pre-JAMA. This is Konami Classic, but very similar to JAMA. It's just the pinout is different, but the voltages and so on are the same. Let me know, because I'm looking for some assistance with arcade stuff. Let's see. All right, so that's what's up with Frogger. And then I wanted to introduce this new project. I showed a little preview of it yesterday. So this is Computer Perfection. This was a 1979 electronic game. and I just picked one up. They're not that expensive on eBay, although if everyone runs out and buys one, they'll become expensive, I'm sure. But this was made by Lakeside, who did a number of other sort of electronic LED and button pressing and sound effect kind of games. This thing is gorgeous, and I've got it taken apart right now. The guts are out of it. We'll take a look at those in a second. But when it's put together, opening that dome turns it on. There's a little switch, a little mechanical contact switch that the dome presses and turns it on. And I can't remember if I showed this last night. I think so. The thing that amazed me, I was getting ready to take it apart. Essentially, the game, even though it's pulled out, once it's on, all the LEDs light up. You pick different games, and then it's essentially pattern guessing and pattern memorization. You press these buttons, and it tells you if you're right or wrong, or it lights up a different LED, and then you have to know that the triangle lights up the circle's LED, and that's the game. Make some noises. Cool thing is, I went to go take it apart because Phil Tyrone said, hey, what about turning this thing into a synthesizer? Went to pick one up and see how it works. So I opened it up, unscrewed the two obvious screws that were right here, thinking I was going to be taking apart a lot of other stuff and pulling this out. As soon as I pulled those out, this thing just magically hinged up like that, which is fantastic. Motherboard there, or PCB rather, was in there. There's a little piezo buzzer. That's what makes all the sounds. I just desoldered the wires that run to the piezo and the wires that run to the switch. So you can see there, that's the little metal contact spring steel type of switch there that turns it on or off. So after desoldering those, I've got the whole board out, and now we can start to look at how this thing works. So let's jump. Let me do this. I think I'll do that first from the bench, and then we'll come back over here to look at some things. Let's see, where's my... Not that one, that one. All right, let me jump over there. So I can turn this light back on here. Okay, let's dive into this. I actually pulled the 4-bit microcontroller that was in there. I'm sorry, I left that in my studio office, so it's not here right now, but you can imagine, zoom in here. Right here in the center was a microcontroller, a little IC, that I've started to diagram how it's connected to the board, but it essentially looked like that. It's 28-pin, and I've got the number of it if someone wants to look it up. I think it was made by Panasonic. The reason I'm mapping it out is that this thing has essentially one pin per switch. So these little metal switches here are what get pressed by the blue buttons in the game. And when those are pressed, they're closing a contact between a common pin, so all 10 of those share a common pin, and the individual switch that's getting pressed. So you can see this beautiful hand-routed board here with these great squigglies on here. The interesting thing is that this does not share, or rather, this does not have a separate pin per switch and LED. They actually share pins, and I believe what the microcontroller was programmed to do was flip back and forth between an input and an output really fast, so fast that you couldn't see that the LEDs were flickering, but essentially they are, because every one of those pins, I think, is watching on an interrupt, and when an interrupt pin notices that you're trying to use it as an input, it for a moment checks all of those switches and then does whatever the game does when that switch has been pressed, and then flips back to lighting whatever LEDs were lit. So essentially the input pins for these buttons are, there are 10 of those, and those are the same exact 10 that are used for the outputs on these LEDs through these resistors. These are 1.5K resistors. This thing ran on 2 9-volt batteries. That the battery cover, of course, is missing there. I might 3D print something if I end up reusing that. However, what I measure, there are two separate inputs for the battery voltage. They're not running combined or anything. They're not in series. So what I've seen is with the board powered on normally, we're getting like 9 volts, 9 volts, 7, 7, 7, 7. I think those sevens are all of the output mode of these button switches before they get pressed. So I'm assuming that that roughly 7, almost 8 volts is what these LEDs are running on, given their size of their resistors and their brightness. I've tried just giving these 3 volts. They're very faint. 5 volts are very faint. So I think those want closer to 8 volts. These two here are my piezo buzzer outputs. And then I also temporarily soldered in a little slide switch where the leaf switch was so that I could test that out. So what I've started to do in mapping out where these run is I've got essentially my buttons 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. So those are the 10 buttons, and they all use this pin 21 here as their common. So what I'm doing is checking the value of the common pin there, which these are going to send current to when they get pressed. So I've got that hooked up to a little Metro M4 right here. I'll just demonstrate that real quick. I've just got three of those pins wired up right now. And I'm going to switch over to this down shooter view of the world. How about, yeah, we'll use that for now. Ignore the code that's there for the moment, but I'll plug this in. I just have to find the right cable. There's one that might work. Okay, so let me grab. By the way, if you're not used to this, if you're using TO or Disco Tool in your terminal to look at the serial output of a CircuitPython board that you have plugged in, if you plug a different board in, if it's got a different name, a different USB port, it's not going to connect automatically. To get out of this, it doesn't tell you, this is one of these mystical things, Control T followed by Q, and then it says fin. Control T followed by Q will cancel you out of the session there, and then we can rerun that now with ME for Metro. So this should be watching for button presses now. I can use my little, and I've got, I think, 0, 1, and 2. Yeah, so these three pins are connected. And I earlier tested giving it like 5 volts to run to those LEDs by flipping the input to an output. That's kind of slow to do in CircuitPython, and I don't love that. It's confusing and complicated, and I'll have plenty of pins on my Metro to run the LEDs kind of normal. So I don't think I'm going to do that twiddling back and forth thing. So I will probably end up severing traces on each resistor that runs to the LED, so I can just run all of these to ground and an output GPIO pin. I got it working, but I don't love it. It makes the code complicated and it confuses me. So we'll see. Maybe someone can talk me out of that. But by the way, one thing I didn't mention is that this game was designed by Ralph Baer, who is often considered to be the father of video games. I believe he built stuff for Magnavox. I think the Odyssey might have been his, or even earlier, like kind of pre-Pong stuff. Often Nolan Bushnell, who later formed Atari, is also called the father of video games. Or Ralph Baer was a really important, influential designer, and he designed this game as well, which is pretty cool. You can go look him up or search the Computer Perfection sort of retro blogs that write up about this kind of stuff. So you can see in my code here, and it's big and messy at the moment, but what I'm doing is I'm setting what I call pin 21, and that's just to map it to the 21st pin slot of what the microcontroller was in there. By the way, one thing that I've got happening here to make my life easier is that I'm using some of our stacking pin headers, which happen to fit into the socket. They're 0.1 inch spacing, and they're thin. They plug into the DIP socket there, and then I can plug in regular jumper cables into those. So that's a way for now. That won't be the permanent solution, but that's the way for now for me to connect to this pretty easily. So that pin 21, I'm creating that as an input pin with a pull-up resistor. So that one is being read to see if anything is happening. The other three pins I'm setting up as outputs. So the pin running to 0, 1, and 2, which happen to be pins 0, 1, and 2 on the Metro. That was just to make my life a little easier remembering who was connected to what. Those are outputs, so those should be sending 3.3 volts when I press this button. What I'm doing is I am periodically setting the value to false and then checking to see if this pin got an input, if pin 21 got an input. So that way all of those can act as outputs, but we kind of are sweeping through and checking, okay, who was it? Who did we check just then? So it's kind of pulling it through like a way a matrix works. So it runs through and it checks which one got pressed. You can see there I've also set up some, just temporarily, some MIDI outputs so that I can have it do something and I can hear if something's changing. So if I run over to my MIDI software real quick and say, yeah, use the Metro as a device. Okay, so it's just running a little arpeggiator when a note gets pressed and held. So what I wanted to do is show you part of this investigation process, since it's such a cool looking PCB and fairly simple. Let me bring in a image viewer real quick. Let's give me one moment to set something up. I just need to open some images and find them first. Where are you? Okay, so make that a little smaller and bring in. Let's see if this will work. This might be a good way to do this. I'm just setting up the images. I think it'll let me kind of slideshow it. That should work. Okay. One moment. All right, preview. There we go. Okay, this will help. So this is the bottom of the board mirrored so that I can look at it in the same view as the top. So I just took a photo of each of the top and the bottom of the board, kind of aligned them in Photoshop. And then I erased everything except for the components. So that lets me kind of flip back and forth, and I kind of made them slightly translucent. So that helps me just look and see, okay, those metal switches there, those contact these, can you see my cursor? Yeah. Those contact these, so there's one side of each metal contact that's actually just soldered to the board but has no traces. That's just mechanically soldering it there. The other side goes to the common, so that in this case is that pin 21. So that's the common for all of those, and then the individual pins are what's in the center. So you can see those metal switches hovering over the pins that they contact. And then what I started to do was just color code these. I'm just literally, there's no magical way to do this. I'm just tracing over stuff real quick with a mouse. It'd be so much easier with a Cintiq or a Wacom pen, but I just happen to be using a mouse for that. And so that shows me the pinout of the socket there going to each of my 10 switches. And then the thing that I just started to do is you can see we've got these three nice actual switches, not buttons, not momentaries, but these three position switches. So I want to figure out, okay, actually this one's four position. Where do those go? How can I use those? So part of my process is just tracing them visually, and then I can go in and see what they, or I can look at it, or I can use the continuity mode of my multimeter to just check and see, okay, what gets closed when one of these is in a certain position, and that means I'll be able to potentially use these as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 different parameters that I could set. The idea with this is to turn it into an interface for a synthesizer running on, knock wood, the Metro M7. So I'm going to be talking with Jepler about potentially using the M7 to generate waveform samples, like single cycle waveforms that can be played back in CircuitPython on the M7. And I want to use these for parameters. So if I want to maybe change the shape of the waveform, maybe I have four waveform shapes that I can pick with this, and I can do some different envelope things with these, modulation with that one, and then press my different buttons and also light up LEDs. So that's the goal with it. This is part of the process. The other part of it is I also brought it into Fritzing. In Fritzing, by the way, you can just say, hey, I'm going to grab an IC and I'm going to make it 28 pins long or whatever. You can pick from this kind of hilariously long drop-down menu enumerated list of pin numbers. It doesn't let you type one in. You just pick from a list. So you pick a 28-pin IC and then you start labeling it in there, which is similar to this sort of approach that I have just on paper. So that'll help me too as I start to integrate that with the microcontroller. Let's see. What is Todd giving me grief about? All right, we need to cut to the chat here for a second. Todd says, "Good luck with that, JP." Are you saying good luck with the synthesizer thing? you know what? Single cycle waveform I may have imposed that idea on it. Actually, Lamore and Jepler said making samples. So not sure what the synthesis mode and method is going to be there. So yeah, timing might be rough with single cycle waveforms. So we'll see. We'll see how that goes. Of course, I can always fall back on MIDI or sample playback of, you know, wave files or something, but it'd be really cool to do some actual synthesis on this thing. So that is pretty much where it's at. Sorry, I left the actual microcontroller chip in the studio inside, so I don't have that to show you. I can't remember if I've got any notes. I don't have any notes up about what it is, but yeah, I'll show that next time if people are curious. It's a 4-bit microcontroller. Todd Bott might remember. We were talking about this earlier. Do you have notes on that? Let me look real quick. It was... the heck was this thing? Scrolling. By the way, hold on. This is... can I show this? Yeah, let me show this. That is sort of the beginnings of my schematic in Fritzing. You can see I did not use net labels here just because I wanted to really visualize where things were connecting. I did use, it's not color-coded the same as my paint over there, but you can see I did start to color-code stuff because I noticed that Fritzing does not draw very big junction points, so it's hard to see where stuff is crossing and not connecting versus connecting. So I used some color there to help. But you can see this is me trying to figure out the LED situation as well as the switch situation. So that blue pin 21 there, that's the common that's running to the two switches, or calling them button 0 and button 1 there. And then they each run to unique pins, in this case pin 15 and pin 2. The LEDs, however, have this, what should I've labeled as 3.3 volts, that should probably be 8 to 9 volts. That is running through the resistor to the LED, and then that is going to need to have the pin twiddled to sync that to ground so that the LED can light up when it needs to light up. Let's see. Let me see. It's an NMOS microcontroller that I remember. I found a website with a schematic of this thing. So MN1400. M as in Michael, N as in November, 1400. Actually, you know what? I'll just take that little squished image and drop that in there. Yeah, so that is the MN1400 made by, I think it says Matsushita on it, and it also says Panasonic on the board. I think they're one and the same. So imagine that flipped on its side. You can see which of those were used as different I.O. pins. There's the ground and voltage to the microcontroller itself, which I kind of don't need or care about since I'm going to be using a separate board there. And yeah, VJ Pussycat says you can always bend it, add stuff at the risk of destroying integrity of it. I think I'm going to. I may end up cutting some traces and just bodging my LEDs to unused pins because there are a number, maybe even 10, unused pins on this 28-pin thing. Should be, maybe. No, maybe not, because of those switches. Those eat up a lot. So the buttons are 10, the switches are, what did I say, like another 10. So I don't have enough to use route through that, but it doesn't matter. I can bodge to it. So we'll come up with a way. Anyway, that is the glorious and beautiful computer perfection dome. Look it up, because this thing got used in some episode of Buck Rogers and the movie Ice Pirates just as a background prop, because the designers of the day saw that and said, oh yeah, that's that thing looks beautiful. I got to use this thing. So and that's why we grabbed it. It looks beautiful. All right. I think that's going to do it. Before I go, I'll remind you, if you want to go get some parts, maybe you want to build your own, maybe you want to sign up to get a Metro M7 when they're in stock. Those should be, I don't think they are right now, but those should be coming back in stock. Maybe they are, I'm not sure. We have that new DVI RP2040 Feather. Has a little DVI HDMI socket on the bottom. That's a cool one. Also coming out soon, so sign up for that one. But if you want to get some current stuff, some things that are in stock, use that coupon code right there on your way out. Brain Battle. I did that backwards. Ready? Brain Battle. Why'd I call it Brain Battle? That's one of the games on... It's one of the four exciting games that you can play on this thing. Countdown, Black Hole, Brain Battle, and Light Race. So type in Brain Battle. You get 10% off at the Adafruit store on your way out. All right. Well, hey, thanks everyone for stopping by and hanging out in the workshop today. I will be back next Thursday to poke around with this some more and show some other cool things. I will not be here on Tuesday. I'm going to be out Tuesday, so there will not be a product pick of the week on the, what is it, the 4th, but there will be on the 11th. So I'll be back the following Tuesday at my usual time, 4 o'clock Eastern, 1 o'clock Pacific, 15,078 Swatch Beat time. I made that up. I don't know what that is. All right. Thanks, everyone, for stopping by. For Adafruit Industries, I'm John Park. This has been John Park's Workshop. I will see you next time. Bye-bye.